All right, we're going full blast now, full blast, early morning here, and I was able to work around the technical problems and get going on this. Speaking of technology, this is very important. There's this belief that somehow technology is progress, it's advancement, it's lifting us out of old traditions and giving us advancement. This isn't true at all. Listen to this. Get the bigger picture. There are many dwelling places in this cosmos, to say the very least. Those people who are adept at technology, who come into this world, they're reincarnating from other planets, okay, from other traditions. I was taken to one of those places, actually, in spirit, and I saw the traditions they had there. And they are totally locked in to the tradition of technology, okay? They're absolutely imprisoned by this tradition of technology. And they come to this planet here, they bring their traditions with them. So they are absolutely locked into this tradition of technology, and they're bringing this here. They're not free of tradition at all. And I'm saying in the previous video, tradition is not good enough. That has to do not only with traditions on this planet, but the traditions on other planets. So this is very, very key to understand that the technology is not progress, or we're not progressing out of tradition. We are simply continuing the imprisonment within tradition, and we need something extra, and that's what this is all about here, is there's something above, beyond tradition and time, space, process, and form. There's something fresh. There's something true. And this, we need this. We need to get, we're not attacking tradition. We're just saying it's not good enough. We need a little something extra. That's all. Speaking of that, let's see if I can boost this light up here a little bit. Why not? Get a little more light on the situation. Throwing more light on it. So, welcome to the video. And tradition is not enough was the previous video. Very important. I'm getting more updates now. Expect four great helpers, four outpourings of grace upon this planet now. I'm aware of three: Jesus, Longchenpa, and Ramana Maharshi. I've been contacted by all three of those, and it's been made clear that they are here, full attention on the situation, pouring out their blessings and their grace and their helping here. Now, I don't know who the fourth is. Maybe I'll be contacted by the fourth at some point. You know, why am I being contacted? It'd be long effort to be available in this way and practicing, full stop in the wow, becoming very spiritually articulate. So that I'm not overwhelmed by any of this. And basically, they just let us know, we're here, and we're here to help. That's all. And I just look, wow, that's great. What do they have? Something fresher, better, a little extra. They bring that little extra, which is what? Eternal life. This is the little extra. Oh yeah, well, you know, where they're aware that all is eternal life. There's only eternal life. Eternal life is the only life there is. There is no other life. We're pretending that there's some other life. There isn't. This is all a pretense. They know this. So they bring the clear, unambiguous, unapologetic knowing that all is eternal life. And this is that extra that is better than tradition. See, tradition is like we're trying to get eternal life, or we're trying to say, God, we're these mortal beings, but, you know, somehow we're going to partake of eternal life or something, you know, something like that. No, we are not mortal beings. We're eternal life. Pretending, holding its breath, as it were. Imagine how we'd feel if we started holding our breath. there's something I'm gonna kill over. You know, it's like, whoa, we're kind of weird, right? So we seem like it's all weird right now, very weird. We're just like holding our breath, holding our spiritual breath, holding our spiritual breath. That's all we're doing. We're pretending to be not eternal life. We're pretending to be mortal life, as if there's something called mortal life. There isn't. There's nothing actually called mortal life. There is no mortal life. All is eternal life. This is all a pretense. So we're going to get help from four heavyweights, okay? Four big heavyweights. Help in taking refuge from the storm here. There's a trap that's been set, which is a trap to make us become completely inarticulate about eternal life and to only focus on our belief in mortal life, okay? This is the trap. Not that it harms eternal life or anything, but it certainly delays our homecoming. You know, in other words, we're going to keep holding our breath and just feel terrible. So this is what's happening, and the trap is going to very soon, within days, so to speak. So I'm very jittery, very nervous. I'm having great troubles, great crisis. Everybody is just in a crisis mode around me. I'm trying to help here, help here, help here. It's like, wow, you know, people are not prepared. They're not, they don't know how to, you know, be quiet. They feel like we've got to be successful. It's like mortal life thinks it has to earn its way into eternal life, or at least to get some benefit, or it has to earn it. We don't have to do anything to earn it. We are eternal life. So it's better to do nothing, to realize I don't need to do anything, and practice this. Except, you know, just exhale, you know, just start breathing spiritually. And yet this is very difficult for most. But step by step by step, we're getting there. And it's very important to recognize that technology itself is an expression of being severely locked into tradition of time, space, process, and form, and the belief in mortality. Okay. The traditions we have around eternal life are not sufficient to boost us past what is coming right now, the trap that is coming. It's not sufficient. We need this little extra, and this is what we're doing, this little extra. Maintain our spiritual articulateness. Be able to talk about this, able to look at it, be able to practice. And otherwise, the tradition, you know, we'll get soaked, because we'll try to take refuge in some tradition, whether it be religion or technology, science or technology or religion. Those aren't good enough. I mean, the science is a tradition too, not just on this planet. All sorts of other planets, they're, you know, obsessed with science. You know, every planet is different, actually, but that's a tradition. They're locked into that tradition. And this does not provide them with the kind of shelter that they need to withstand what the ego is bringing upon us right now, which is to stun us into inarticulateness, really. And when we're so stunned, then the ego can make us feel that we're mortal, and the cup is half empty, you see. And then we feel we have to do something to earn. We feel we have to earn our merit. You know, this is the trouble. Then we think we need to strive and try to accomplish and arrive and, you know, finish. And there's things we have to do. None of that is true. We have to actually realize that we never left. We never left. This is a realization that we're aiming for, is that we never left. We never left eternal life. How could we leave eternal life? We never threw it away. We can't throw it away. So the real spiritual path is different than what tradition tells us it is. It's different. And it's you know, the path, free path. It's wherever you are, realize that you've always been where you are. You've always been in eternal life. You've never left it. And this is different than thinking, I gotta get it, I gotta get it, where can I find it? You know, it's calling off the search. It's calling off the search, progressively calling off the search. And you do this by experiencing the wow, like wow. You get little glimpses and saying, I'm eternal life right now? Yes. I didn't earn it? No. I don't need to do anything to sustain it? No. I mean, I'm just pretending to be dead? Yes, I'm just pretending to be dead. And so this gradually seeps into us, and every time we get a little glimpse, it's astonishing. We don't know what to say, right? How can you put that in the tradition of striving and accomplishing and trying to gain merit? And thinking that you're mortal and somehow you're trying to, you know, gain favor with immortality, with eternal life, you're trying to gain favor with it. You know, that doesn't work. That doesn't work. Those are the early steps, you know, that are helpful, but they're not enough. They're not enough. We have the ego is pushing things now to collapse our articulateness. It's saying, whoa, you're getting too close. We gotta shut it all down. Let's shut it all down. We don't want to, you know, go back and let's go back into, you know, we're just mortal flesh and trying to develop a nice civilization that makes mortal flesh happy and kind of, you know, this is the ego. So, already three. Now, will there be four? My mind's open to that. I've seen that perhaps there will be four great helpers right now. You know, really, really, really tremendously substantial help. And we will become aware of this. And this is a huge wow, right? I mean, who right now expects eternal life to show up in some way in the world for us? You know, I mean, do we feel worthy? This is the question, we feel worthy. Is it, for me, I'm struggling with it every day, you know, and I hopefully I can go with it. You know, hopefully I can go with it. I feel that I can. But keep in mind, when this happens, we'll be pretty inarticulate from the wow, but it's a positive inarticulateness. And this is what has to be emphasized. There is this positive inarticulateness where you're shocked by your great good fortune. And you say, I just can't even express. I mean, I don't. And this is, I'm in the wow right now. I cannot express it very well. You can't express gratitude. You cannot express how wonderful. Thank you. You know, you just feel like you're just shocked. When people are in shock, they're not very able to be very expressive or articulate, right? They're not flowing very well. They're in temporary shock. So the important thing is to understand that temporary shock is a positive thing. And then when it wears off, you'll be able to be wonderfully expressive and articulate. And by articulate, I don't mean just speaking. I mean an overall flowing and move and beingness. Okay, it's articulating your beingness in all ways that beingness does this here. So, this is the bridge that we have, is the bridge to eternal life, is eternal life reminds us that we too are eternal life. And we have to then go through this period of the shock and say, oh my gosh. And in the shock, you don't have to say anything or express anything at all. This is what's important. You don't need to be expressive. In fact, intentionally be inarticulate. And this is how we differ here with the world, is we're literally intentionally, with full consciousness and awareness and choice, choosing to be inarticulate for a little while. See, this is very different than being thrust into it and struggling with it. We're saying no. We are going to practice being inarticulate. And so we're embracing it. And we know it's temporary. And it's a glass half full. We go into it with this glass half full. This is the power. Whereas those who get thrust into it, they feel glass half empty. And then they start struggling with it. And that's when they start falling down, 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 down. And disastrous for them. So what we do in the practice is we embrace the full stop in the wow. Neither advancing or retreating. We're not enhancing or diminishing. We're just in this neutral mode and say, this is okay. This is wonderful. Now, when you come in contact with eternal life, you're going to need to practice this because it's going to be overwhelming at times. And you will be able to go with it at times, and then you'll start feeling like, you know, this is just too much. Then embrace the full stop and the wow. It's essential. Just go quiet. Not in a depressed way. Not at all. See, this is the difference between depression and progress. Depression is you see the glass half empty, saying, oh my gosh, I'm not relating. I'm what's wrong with me? We don't do that here. We say, this is a sign of great progress for us, but that we need to catch our breath. It's like we're doing wind sprints. Then we have to catch our breath. We say, hey, intentionally, I'm going to take a little break here. I'm going to be quiet. I'm going to be still and quiet. And we have to have faith that the eternal life understands this very, very well. And this, because this is how we acclimatize ourselves to it. It's like you climb up, climbing high altitude, you're going to take a little break because you got to acclimatize to it. So it's all about acclimatization to eternal life, because this is what we are. There's no way to escape it. We can never throw away eternal life. It's impossible. No matter how much we try, it's still with us. And this is the ego so upset. Says, I can't succeed. What's the matter with me? I got to, you know, got to try harder. You know, to we cannot throw away eternal life. It's what we are. And so how do we get reacclimatized to it? This is the question. This is what we're working on here. Because I have this feeling of certainty that this is going to take place. And I've been contacted by so many of these great teachers. Why? To help get acclimatized to it. That's why. You know, in advance, get acclimatized to it. So, you don't do it when you start getting overwhelmed. You don't do it by thinking more and more and more and more and more and speaking more and more. You go quiet, but positively quiet. It's a full stop in the wow. And you're not thinking or strategizing about how are you going to advance after you stop being quiet. You're just being purely quiet and just taking a break from it. Not thinking at all. Neutral. Not thinking about the past, not thinking about the future. Keep in mind that eternal life we cannot leave it. We cannot discard it. So just because we're not thinking or strategizing, that doesn't mean it's going to leave us. It cannot leave us. In fact, that's the shocking thing we need to get used to. We're so used to believing we can leave it. That the recognition that we cannot is so stunning that we have to be very careful not to, you know, that we have to understand we're going to retreat from that. So we co-opt the retreat. We co-opt it. And we say, no, I'm going to do an intentional full stop right here instead of allowing my reactions of retreat to gain momentum. I'm going to fire break it. I'm going to fire break this. And so you start, you intentionally do this sort of intentional retreat of neutrality. Say, well, I'm not going to say yes or no to it. Is eternal life always present? I'm not going to say yes it is, and I'm not going to say no it isn't. I'm going to say it's both yes and no. It's both yes and no. You go into this little intentional retreat, neutrality, a little break. And then gradually the panic retreats, wears off. This is acclimatization. Because the truth is that when you experience your true nature, you realize it's always present like this, just perfectly. It's perfect, always present. This is so shocking to us. It's effortlessly present and can never change or leave. You know, it's just the perfection of its presence is so stunning to us. That our tendency is to retreat. Absolutely, our tendency is to go back to what we're familiar with, which is striving. So what we do is we take that striving and turn it into striving for neutrality, for full stopness. Strive for that. And it's neutrality. You say maybe yes, maybe no. I'm not judging. I'm not going to judge this. Is this true or is it not true? I'm not going to judge it one way or the other. Because judging, you'll start thinking about it, conceptualizing it, trying to conceptualize it. And we cannot conceptualize the self, the truth, eternal presence. We cannot conceptualize eternal presence. Whatever we try to conceptualize, and we're damning it with faint praise and trying to define it. So we say maybe yes, maybe no. Both yes and no. Cancel out concepts. Practice canceling out concepts. I am both and neither, eternal presence and not eternal presence. And keep in mind, since eternal presence is what is true, it's good enough to simply not deny this. Okay. To not deny it, to not to go into denial of it. So going into neutrality about it is good enough. It's good enough. As we get used to the seeming neutrality of not judging either for or against it, what is true will dawn upon us as we're in this intentional neutral mode. It will dawn upon us. If we're saying neither yes nor no, then what is true will make its presence felt to us. See, we don't have to judge for truth. It's already true. It doesn't require judgment. It's only denial of truth that requires our judgment, actually. So when we suspend judgment, we're really allowing denial of truth to evaporate away, to evaporate away. So the highest practice is this neutrality and zeroing out concepts and judgment. Assertion practice, in terms of saying, yes, I am eternal life, I am eternal life, this helps us, reassures us, but we're still in judgment and conceptuality mode. But when we go into zeroing out concepts and judgment, this is a further advancement, actually. Yes, I already know that I am both and neither, eternal life and not eternal life. Yes, I already know that I'm both and neither, eternal life and not eternal life. Yes, I am both and neither, eternal life and non-eternal life. So the positive assertions get us in touch with reassuring us, yes, I can accept this. Yes, I can accept it. It's there. It's there for me. It's there for me. And once we realize it really is there for us, then the final, highest practice is then to cancel out these concepts about it, because it cannot be put into a concept. We will feel as if it's not really there entirely for us. If we look at it conceptually in any way, even though the most positive concept, like, I truly am the one eternal, perfect life right now. Okay. It's good to practice that way. All right. I truly am the one perfect eternal life right now. And we feel positive about that. So this is a very high practice. And then there's one practice that's even higher than that. So we don't need to exclude the positive affirmations. Okay, I want to make this clear. And we're not excluding the tradition of affirming, our divinity and et cetera and prayers. No. So we continue to do that. But we also introduce this zeroing out of all concepts, purging of all concepts. And this leads to actual abidance. This leads to actual abidance, whereas the positive assertions lead to glimpses of it. We get glimpses of it, but then we're not able to abide in it because our concepts, like, oh my gosh, I really am perfect eternal life. This is great. I am the one eternal, perfect presence of eternal life. Oh my gosh, this is great. But we're reacting to it instead of abiding in it. Okay, we're reacting to it conceptually and forming a judgment and conception about it, and then we're not actually abiding in it. So the great ones are actually abiding in it. This is the only difference that we have, is they're abiding in it. We're glimpsing it, right? They're abiding in it. And there is a way to abide in it, which is this higher practice of canceling out concepts. But don't think that you're being told that you have to forego, your tradition and, prayer, affirmation, thank you, God, gratitude, all this stuff. Positive concepts, in other words, the traditions have been to establish positive concepts, positive judgment for God and wellness and all this stuff. Okay. And you can get those better and better and better and better and refine that, which is what we've been doing. And then beyond that, there's this even more effective practice, which that leads to abidance, that actually enables you to abide in the presence of eternal life, abide in it, where you're not reacting to it, you're not conceptualizing, judging. You just say, I'm as we practice this, the fear that we need to judge what we are begins to be evaporating. Judgment is always in the service of denial. And because we have a continuity fear, we're going to go into denial of it. You know, we'll just say, whoa, that's too good for me. I'm not used to that. You catch a glimpse and go, oh my gosh, you know, how can I, that's amazing. You know, I don't know what to say, what to think, how to judge it. It's beyond judging. How can I judge that? You know, we don't have to judge truth. It's not dependent on, we didn't create truth. Okay, we did not create what we are. We did not create eternal life. God did. So we don't have to judge it for it to be what it is. So we have the full palette here. We have the full palette. So why should we be afraid of eternal life coming back into the world in some way, or some sort of presence of it? We have the palette of practice, the full palette, okay? We can do our positive affirmations. We can talk about flipping the script and being articulate that way. And we can do full stop in the wow. And then even beyond positive assertions, we can do canceling out practice. This is the full palette. This is the full palette. We have it. We have it. So what are we concerned about? Why should we be feel like overwhelmed? No, I don't feel overwhelmed. I know I can practice all of this full palette. In the past, what did the eternal life showed up in this world? The abidance in eternal life instead of the denial. The abidance in eternal life showed up in this world. And what happened? People practiced the practice. They used that as a practice. We're no different than that. We're not inferior to any past situations at all. We have the awareness of the full palette of practice here. And I know that we can do it. So we don't have to feel like somehow we cannot handle something like this. No. And we don't. It's simple. We don't have to get lost in the complexity. The problem is that, in the past, we've gotten. There's a tendency to get lost in too much technique, too much, trying to be more and more sophisticated. It gets very complex and esoteric and all this stuff, and we think, oh my gosh, it's overwhelming. But it's really very simple. It's very, very simple. We just have to recognize, where are we at? There are these different stages. There's different stages. There's a longing for something better stage. And then there's, a praying for something better stage. And then there's there's petitioning for something better stage. Then there's an asserting that I have this. I already have this. There's an assertion that I have this. And then there's the final canceling out of even the positive assertions of, I'm neither this nor that. I am both this and not this. I am both this and not this. I am both here and not here. I am both everywhere and not everywhere. You know, that's the final, highest practice. So there's these four stages. And so we can just, recognize this, say, okay. So the first stage is this longing, say, I don't feel, right. I want something better. I want to appeal to something, please. I don't feel right about mortal life. There's something about mortal life that I don't like, and I'm acknowledging this. The second phase is praying. This is more like the religious life we're used to. Is, please God, anoint me with your blessing. I'm this, poor suffering mortal sinner, and I'm so desperate. I can you not please lift some of the affliction off of me? All the Psalms, it's like in the Bible, the Psalms, that's like the second stage. Please lift this affliction off of me, Lord, and take, I know I do so much wrong, but can you, it's like this, pray, you're asking, petitioning. That's the second phase. The third phase is when you start getting clued in, like, hey, this is just all pretense. I need to start asserting, I am eternal life. I am the eternal presence. I'm already this. Yes, I already know that I'm already this. Yes, I already know that I'm already that. Yes, I already know I'm already eternal life. This is what's called the third phase. Okay, you can, and in you know you can call this the what is that? Anyway, that's the third phase. Call it what you like. New thought, you know, you call it new thought phase. That Christian Science, new thought. A lot of, you know, there's a lot of high sort of tradition in the world that is like that. Of Course in Miracles helps with that, right? This is the third phase. Then the fourth phase is ultimately employing the canceling out of all concepts, including all the positive ones. So, naturally, you know, each phase is jittery about the next phase. Like, wow, I don't know if I can take that step. And of course, there are many who are not even taking, haven't gotten on the path yet. And they're just saying, no, I'm a mortal body, but science will make me happy. Okay. They're not even started yet. There's a lot like that. But at some point you say, you know what? I don't think I'm ever going to be satisfied being a mortal soul, body, whatever you want to call it. I just don't feel I'm ever going to be satisfied. And then you say, oh my gosh, this is, you know, what do? I just, you know, help. I just don't think I'm going to be satisfied. Then you're in, you know, phase one. Then phase two, as you begin to plead, help, God, I don't want to be a mortal body. What can you do? Can you do anything you can do for me? Anything you can do for me? I don't know how I can be happy. You know, please, I want help. What do I need to do? I'll be good. You know, how can I be good? You know, I'll pray for your help. I'll try to help others. I mean, we need something. You know, there's that second phase, third phase. Hey, wait a minute. This is all make-believe. This is all pretense. I put myself into this. This is the new thought. You know, nothing's outside of my mind. I can't separate from eternal life. It's impossible. I am eternal life. I am the one mind. I've never separated. All is perfect. You know, I'm not lost. God is not angry. I don't need to petition. Nothing ever happened. I never left. You know, the certain positive assertions. And then the fourth phase again is canceling out even those positive assertions. I both never left and never did not leave. Okay? I both never left and never not left. I'm both here and not here. Yes, I already know that I'm absolutely both here and absolutely not here. I'm both absolutely here and absolutely not here. I'm both absolutely eternal life and absolutely not eternal life. What this does is it gets you to the point where you can abide without judging or conceptualizing or reacting to it, you see. So that's the final step, is abidance is the final step. So we have all four, awareness of all four steps here. So why should we be surprised if eternal life shows up for us? Because it will know. It'll say, no, okay, you can handle it. You understand there are these four phases, and you're going to be able to, you know, keep it fairly clear. And each one needs to practice where they're at, and then also start listening to the next phase, start become articulate about this, to say, hey, maybe there's some more phases here, you know, that I can get to. And so if I can just practice, you know, with the phase I'm in, and realize that I need to start dabbling in the next phase, okay? I need to start dabbling in it. You know, you need to have momentum on this thing. Don't get locked into one phase and shut down and say, this is it. It's either this or nothing. And if God doesn't help me with this, forget it, you know? You have to start hearing the next phrase. Okay, what does that need? You improve your practicing. Improve your practicing. It's like if you're a musician, you want to be a virtuoso. You say, I can't get just locked into this one phase of, you know, playing this way. I mean, this is fine for just starters, but let me tackle a little different song. Like if you're a piano player, you know, you get the sheet music and you start out and you play this song and, oh, I did it. You know, I did another one. Oh, I did it. And I mean, I took piano lessons and of course, in a previous life, I was a virtual piano virtuoso. And so this life, I took lessons again. I did this song. I could play all these songs and I said, wow, but you know, this, I need something more difficult. Come on. And then get something more difficult. And you struggle for a while. Eventually you play that. Then you get something more difficult. You struggle for that and for that for a while. And then I realize, I can play anything on the piano. I mean, I've already done it, but I want another challenge. So I took up the guitar, you know, this, because that was in vogue here, which is a very different sort of discipline as far as how to play a guitar as a piano. But it was still music. And then I realized, hey, this music is never going to give me what I really want. And then it's spiritual practice that is necessary. And so you keep, you know, the sheet music, you keep saying, oh, today I'm going to play something a little more difficult, more challenging, because you have to become a virtuoso. You have to get to the fourth phase practicing, where we all have to get to abidance in what we are. And ultimately, that which we cannot even speak about or practice is going beyond even abidance, where it's just pure knowing. But this is nothing that we can practice or even talk about or aim for at all. So it's not, you know, it's not, that's something that'll automatically transpire, you know, from the abidance in eternal life, just abiding in it. But we should not try to conceptualize that. Okay, it's very important. Do not try and even approach or concept that at all. That, it's off the table. It's inherently off the table. So we are, you know, we understand abidance in this. And the feeling of eternal life is abidance in this. Is our goal, and this is a goal that is reachable. It's absolutely reachable. So again, look at yourself and say, what is your aim? Is to be a spiritual virtuoso? It's everyone's aim ultimately. And for me, I embraced it. I said, yeah, that's my goal in life. I'm going to be a spiritual virtuoso. I've already been an artistic virtuoso. That wasn't it. That wasn't it. Didn't get me what I wanted. Not at all. I mean, I've been there and done that. And all the fame, all the adulation, oh, you're so great, you know, you do all this, you're, you know, the master of music, and well, did it bring me happiness? Did it bring me satisfaction? No, 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 and no. On no account did it get me what I wanted. So I said, uh-oh. Wow. But then I said, wait a minute, I have all this skill in practicing and discipline. Let me use this on the spiritual path, you see. And so I said, okay, I know I can, you know, reach the pinnacle if I just really apply myself and keep practicing. And this is what we all have to do. There's no way around it for anyone. And so wherever you are, you just realize, hey, you know, I do need to be disciplined. I do need to be determined. I can do it. I can do it. That's what I want. Mortal life will never satisfy me, no matter how much fame I have, no matter how much proficiency in any direction, it will never, ever remotely satisfy me. So why even bother trying to achieve, you know, fame and fortune as a mortal body, so to speak? Right? Why even bother? Jesus says, don't try to lay up your treasures in this world, this mortal world, right? This dream of mortality. Don't try to lay up your treasures there. Meaning, don't try to be, you know, famous and popular and successful and all this kind of stuff. He said, no. Lay it up in, quote unquote, the world to come, which means eternal life, that life. Aim for that. Aim for that. And you'll reach it. You'll reach it. So, So we have this wonderful situation here where there's an awareness of these four stages. And this helps simplify it all for us. You know, we don't have to struggle so much. And we can practice, you know, various phases. And there's ups and downs. It's difficult, you know, like say you're playing piano and you learn a song great and you play for everybody. Everybody's like, wow, you know, that's tremendous. That's a really great job you did. I remember I used to do that for release. I could play that so beautifully, you know, just like people would say, oh, wow, you're such a wonderful piano player. Yeah, that's great. And get all the mothers, you know, and people to think, look at my, you know, just look at, it's wonderful. Look how talented, you know, the mortal body is to be able to play this. It's beautiful. It's just wonderful. But for me, I say, oh, come on, you know, I want to try something more different. I need to expand my repertoire, get better. So try to do something different, you know. And people would say, ah, it doesn't sound so good. And you know, you're struggling. The approval vanishes, you know. Where I would just compose on the piano. I just started composing. All sorts of sounds and tones and things and playing with it, you know, being creative. But that's where the audience disappears, you know. They want to hear you play a lovely production piece, you know. Oh, thank you. It sounds so nice. That's, you know, that's what they think. Oh, my mortal experience here is I'm getting some candy, you know. That's nice. I need some candy. I need some entertainment for this mortal body experience. It's just, entertainment junkie. So they saw me, oh, you can be such a great entertainer, but they want me to play the songs they want. Yeah, for me, said, no way. I'm going to experiment. I'm going to improvise. I'm going to expand. I'm going to do more. What's more difficult, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And so you lose your audience. So, same thing in this world right now, like new thought, there's a lot, you know, all the affirmations that are going around, there's very, you know, which is great, it's great, that's a stage. But you get a big audience, you get all these people, you know, saying, okay, I can affirm, I get this house, I get this relationship, I get this car, and, you know, they're into, you know, using, you know, awareness and, you know, empowerment, combining awareness and empowerment, you know, that kind of thing. And, you know, people hear that and say, oh, that's great, you know, because it's avoiding the four stages, isn't it? It's avoiding it. Which is canceling out all concepts, both of success and failure, both. Yeah, I already know I'm both and neither, completely successful and not completely successful. That I have, I'm both and neither, yes, I already know that I'm both and neither, I have arrived and not arrived. That I have accomplished and not accomplished. That I have succeeded and not succeeded. Yes, I already know I'm both and neither, absolutely succeeded and absolutely not succeeded. So, you don't want to get stuck in affirmations. You don't want to get stuck there. That's not the answer, actually. Jesus points this out to us. He always says, you know, even when you're trying to affirm, like, I'm so well, I'm healthy, I'm well, he says, that's still the ego. It's still, you know, but not saying that it's bad to do that, okay? But he says, you're still trapped. There's still a trap, okay? Instead, you have to go even beyond that. But now we know what it is. I'm getting familiar with it. It's like, it's kind of shocking. And I'm still shocked by it. You know, it just caused a shock in me for sure. Holy cow, you know. It seems scary. I'm canceling out even, you know, the positive concepts. You know, how can I be happy then? I thought, you know, positive concepts will make me happy. Now, only abiding in eternal life will make us happy. Will be only that makes us feel right. You know, we feel that everything, all is right. And eternal life is never can be something that is defined, conceptually defined, or judged. You know, there's nothing outside to judge it. Judge not, lest ye be judged. When you judge eternal life, you feel it's judging you, and you don't feel then your eternal life. Judgment gets in the way. So I already know that I am both and neither, perfectly clear and perfectly not clear. I'm perfectly clear and perfectly not clear. Perfectly sane and perfectly not sane. Perfectly happy and perfectly not happy. So the trouble is with eternal life, the real heavyweights. If we think that the highest practice is these positive affirmations, we still won't be able to relate properly with them. We will not be able to entertain them properly, and the wheels will start coming off, and we'll, you know, it. You have to go to this higher practice ultimately. So this is great that we have it now. So it's like, you know, panic time's over, really. We've got it. I've got it. Which means being able to share it with the world here. That means that everybody has it to some degree. You know, it's been articulated here. Just in time, before the storm, you know. And so we're not, it's like we found a safe harbor, you know. And we're looking out, and we look at the ocean and say, oh my God, you know, this is a horrible storm. But why should we be worried? You know, we're in this beautiful, calm harbor now. And we realize we can how to stay in the harbor. We don't need to go out of the harbor into the ocean and be fishing out there. You know, let's say like we're fishermen and we see the storm in the ocean. Say, oh my God, the storm is not going to end for a long time. This is horrible. How are we going to go out and fish? How are we going to feed ourselves? You know, wow, yeah, whatever. And we think we have to go out there. No, we don't. We can stay in this harbor. Full stop in the wow. It's okay to stay in the safe harbor as the ocean is roaring. You know, it's okay. There's plenty of fish in the harbor, actually. But we're so used to going out in the ocean, that's our functioning. We think, oh, we've got to go out on the open ocean. That's what we do. And then we say, but how can we do that? We're going to be swamped. We're going to sink and drown. The ocean is too ferocious. It's incredibly ferocious. Very interesting. I just called to mind something. Someone who just came back from vacation told me that where they were, that there's only one area they could be on the beach, because the ocean was so ferocious. Huge waves, 20-foot waves. You'd be swept away and drowned immediately. It is way too dangerous. The ocean was just extremely powerful and stormy. Very interesting. Amazing how these things happen, isn't it? The Holy Spirit's orchestrating everything. Thank God for the Holy Spirit. This is the trouble. But there was an area on the beach where you're okay. You know, you can be there. See? So, there is a safe harbor for us. It's just that we have to feel that it's okay that we're not functioning the way we used to, like going out, sailing out into the open ocean, catching fish, so to speak. You know, we're just going to take it easy here in the harbor for a while. And our functioning has been based on trying to be happy with mortality. You know, how can we be happy with mortality? And now we're finding out, you know what, we don't have to be more happy with mortality because we can acclimatize ourselves to eternal life. We have the capacity to do that. And inside everyone's mind, there's been this sort of nagging doubt, like, I'm not sure I can do it. But now that this fourth phase practice has been brought to light here, we've been aiming for this, and it's finally really clicked in and crystallized. And so with this practice, this removes the final doubt. You can say, oh, okay, I didn't quite understand before, but now I'm starting to see it. Even the most highly positive judgments and explanations, etc., that too is damning reality with faint praise. It is still involving judgment, and it's preventing my abidance. That's what's preventing my abidance. However, it's easy to evaporate that. There's a practice we can use to evaporate it. And once we are abiding in eternal life, we don't need to try to become happy as mortal existence, right? This is completely unnecessary. You didn't see Ramana Maharshi frantically trying to do things to be happy with his mortal life. He says, I'm absolute, I'm eternal life. It's perfect. There's nothing I need to do mortally in this mortal realm to earn this or to keep it or anything at all. I'm not the slightest bit concerned. Complete lack of concern. I mean, people say, well, Ramana, you're just wasting your life. You're just sitting still like a statue. You're not getting with God's plan. I mean, you're not, you know, thriving. You're not producing. You know, where's your family? Where's your education? Where's your building? Where's your entrepreneurship? Where's your service? You're not evolving the mortal experience. Yeah, it's not a word. You just stand quiet. And he said, no, all this is just, the mortal realm is just like, it's just a mirage. It's nothing. We are eternal life. There's only eternal life. This is just a dream of mortality. So let the dream go. Don't try to find fulfillment within the dream. Let the dream go. But how do we do that? How do we abide in the self, you know? And the people asking different ways. And of course, those who are really into achievement want the fastest way, right? Always. Well, you know, entrepreneur says, Ramana, this is great. Okay, how do I get this? And Ramana said, just, you know, where's the I come from? Just inquire. Where does this I thought come from? Just focus on that. So those who are really like motivated, you know, for success, you know, it gives them something to chew on. You're like, oh yeah, do this. But that really, that's not the only advice he gave at all. But he said he gave that out. He gave out various advice, and depending on the personality, depending on, you know, who was asking, where the asking was coming from. And there's some who are so, you know, they say, I'm really successful in this mortal life, and I just need to put the capstone on my success. So, you know, how can I be successful spiritually? Just tell me, and then I can, you know, tackle that too. And so he said, okay, just, you know, simple. Here's simple advice. And of course, It's also true. It's a true truism to it also, but it's for that type of mentality. Now, for me, I never resonated with that at all. I understood that you have to put this tremendous effort into it. Most people are so gung-ho on, you know, how do I attain happiness as a mortal being? And they think that some sort of spiritual success will bring happiness to the mortal experience. You know, this is delusion. There is no mortal experience, actually. Never has been. and this will dawn upon us, that there's never been any mortality at all. There's never been a mortal experience. There's never been the flesh. The flesh doesn't exist. You can never touch the flesh. It's never existed. You know, this is why people get into special relationships and sex and passion, and you know, they want to touch the flesh, they want to experience the flesh. There is no flesh. There isn't any flesh. It doesn't exist. Never has. There's only eternal life. You see, when this dawns upon us, this is a shock, right? To realize there's never been any flesh. This is not flesh, actually. There isn't any flesh at all. We can't touch it. You know, a lot of people are trying to find maybe the mother, the goddess, is flesh in the body. And if we just find her, we'll finally be able to experience the flesh. We'll never be able to experience the flesh. It doesn't exist. It's never existed. Never will. No such thing can ever take place. We think that death proves that the flesh is there. No, it doesn't prove that at all, actually. So if we give up the belief in the flesh, we don't need death at all, actually. Because death, really, we're trying to prove. Death is just our attempt to prove that flesh is real. But if we accept that the flesh isn't real, why do we then need to try to prove it that it is? We don't have to. So, bing, you know, just like, oh, it's all gone. Just like that. So seeing how easy it is to be liberated from this misery, this is shocking. We thought, oh, this long trek path, you know, and suddenly we see, oh, it's just simple as that. Wow. You mean I can be free of death right now? Absolutely. In fact, I'm already free of it. I've never been the flesh. There isn't any flesh. We're trying to kill spirit. We're trying to produce flesh. We can never produce flesh. We label this flesh, we call it a name as if magically this will make it so, but it's not so. All is eternal life, always. All is eternal life, always. And then even higher practice, yes, I already know. I already know that I'm both abiding in eternal life and not abiding in eternal life. Cancel out the concept. And right now, people are going to be desperate to experience the flesh. This is the problem in the world, is people are going to be desperate for mortal satisfaction and to cling to mortality, belief in mortality. And this is what's being pressed upon people. And they're also desperate to get free of it. So there's this vulnerability that the planet is going to go through. And then there's those set up to exploit this vulnerability, as I've called the pirates. Pirate prostitutes who say, yeah, you want to experience flesh? Here I am. I'm real flesh, you know. You can experience it through me. But it's going to cost you an arm and a leg and everything you got. You see, this is the trouble right now. There are many, 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 many vast amounts of those in this world who've recognized the opportunity for exploitation as we go through the situation where many in the world say, wait a minute, I don't really want to keep on going on the same path of mortal experiencing, trying to be mortal, and yet I'm not really sure what to do. There's this vulnerability that arises then, and there's a tendency then for you to think, well, if I just, you know, it's like last call at the bar, oh my gosh, let me order up one last drink. And that's when these pirate prostitutes will make their move and say, hey, I know you really want to experience the flesh, you just haven't met the right person, but here I am, you know, and I'm here for you, and I'm going to give you the experience of the flesh, the real experience that you've been looking for. And then this is what will cause you, male and female, to fall into the pit, as it were. So we're saying there's an option to that. There's an option to actually, there's a way to progressively acclimatize yourself to recognize there is no flesh. I'm eternal life. I've always been eternal life. The flesh is really, has never existed. I was just pretending. I was holding my breath, you know. The fact that I'm holding my breath doesn't mean that I cease to exist. And so we have complete sovereignty over everything. So how could there be the flesh? There can't be. It's just appearances, imagery, from our spiritual will and desire. But it can be anything at all. It's not, there isn't any body, process, time, space, process, and form. It doesn't exist. It's never existed, actually. None of that has ever existed. It's only a wish, wishful thinking on our part. It's never actually existed at all. This is what someone like Ram Maharshi knows. You know, he knows this. It's just all mirages. You know, you think you're trapped. You think that this flesh is real. It's not. You think that this death is real. It's not. None of it is real. None of it is true. So instead of getting preyed upon by the pirates, we take refuge in practice, realizing there are these steps we can take, and realizing we can reach abundance in eternal life, and recognize this has all just been a dream. We've never been touched by it. We've never been touched by the flesh. We've never been the flesh. Nobody has. Not even the goddess has been the flesh. See, this is our hope, that somewhere flesh exists, and we think there's this goddess who really is the flesh, who actually has, you know, found as is true embodiment of spirit, right? And that if we just find her, you know, oh, we'll be mortally satisfied. Say, okay. See, but our dissatisfaction is with this belief that we're mortal. This and only eternal life will satisfy us. And eternal life is a recognition we've always been eternal. We've never been mortal. See, we've never been the flesh. It's not like we become eternal by first being satisfied by the flesh and then become, that will never work, because this is denial of eternal life. It's a denial. So it's enough to cancel out the denial, right? Cancel out the denial. And we feel comfortable doing this by canceling out both the positive and the negative together like this. We don't need the positive ultimately, because the fact is, truth is true, and we've always been eternal life. We've never, ever fallen away from that in the slightest bit, actually. When the dreamer sits in a bed and we go to sleep, and we go to all these places in the dream, is the dreamer ever leaving the bed at all? The answer is, of course, no. So it's, see, the trap that we're getting is this, we're being told that, yes, we are the flesh, but don't worry, we can treat it with drugs and medicine and all this stuff, and we'll find a way to have a happy mortal life. This is not true at all. The right truth is that we've never been the body. The body doesn't exist. There isn't any flesh. It's a misperception, a mislabeling. So we don't make illusions, try to make illusions true, and then try to get rid of them. That's a false path. We assert, no, illusions have never been true. Only truth is true. Illusions can never be true. Very black and white, see. It's not some compromise. Yeah, well, they're both true. No. Truth and lies are not both true. But to cancel out concepts, we say, I am both truth and not truth. See, the concept of being true and the concept of not being true, those are equally zero, right? Let's zero them out. Only the belief in mortality requires judgment and concepts. So as we cancel out judgment and concepts, we're also evaporating the belief in mortality, the belief in the flesh. So it is not possible to first experience flesh and then say, okay, well, I don't like it, or that satisfies me, now I can go on. That's not possible. I know dualistic, double nature, Christianity says that Jesus' spirit became flesh, literally became flesh, and that saved us, you know, that it proves that spirit can become flesh, and that there is flesh, is true, it's real. It is not true. It was only an apparition. It was only an appearance. It was only an accommodation. But Jesus knew that he wasn't flesh. Spirit knows that cannot become flesh. There's no such thing as flesh. Jesus said, you know, what are you, leprosy? Gone, what are you talking about? You don't need leprosy. You're not the flesh. Flesh isn't real. Only spirit is real. Flesh is nothing. It doesn't exist. It's never existed. It's just a term, a belief, a wish that we have. We're just wishing it to be so, but Jesus said, it's not so, it's not so. The Christians, Christology, decided, no, that Jesus was dual nature, both flesh and not flesh. But in our practice, we say, yes, I already know that I'm absolutely not flesh, and absolutely am flesh. Absolutely, or how to say in a positive way, how do we say that? So we cancel out both. I am both and neither the flesh and not the flesh. I am both and neither the flesh and not the flesh. I am both and neither spirit and not spirit. I am both and neither spirit and not spirit. But we know that we are eternal spirit, but we're working on canceling out concepts, you see. And so we're not going to get abide in the knowingness until we cancel out the concepts and abide in the, have this abidanceness, and then ultimately the knowingness will be there. That's beyond our goal. We're going to have the abidance first. Now, I'd say all this is going to happen quicker than we think, the trouble in the world. For example, I was supposed to take someone today at 6 o'clock. I was supposed to take them somewhere. And I said, okay. Okay, no problem. If somebody else couldn't make it, I was going to take him somewhere. And then suddenly, early in the morning, I get this call and say, hey, we're late, you're late. I said, what? Well, it's the time in the morning, you got to take them. I said, what do you mean, what? I thought you said it's an afternoon. No, it's in the morning. So it happened earlier than I thought. You see, it was miscommunication. So I had to get up early and take someone somewhere like that. And I said, that's okay. I was able to do it. So this storm is going to come upon people, the world, sooner than we think. But for me, it's okay, I'm ready. And we don't need to worry what format the storm takes. We understand the situation. And the great idea that we've been able to recognize here is that there is no flesh. And people are desperate to experience the flesh. They think they need that first to be saved. Like they think that God created the flesh, and we're supposed to find fulfillment in the flesh, and we can only really be saved by finding fulfillment in the flesh. Then maybe after that, then we get to go to heaven or something like that. God did not create any flesh. There is no flesh. So how can God have created flesh? There is no body. Not really. Not really. It's a convention that we have come up with of belief and wishful thinking. But there really isn't a body. You know, those who are liberated from this false belief can just appear or disappear, can bilocate, whatever. Yeah, they know they're not the body, that there's no such thing as the body, really. It's just an appearance, a projection of the mind. There is no flesh. So the stampede of the lemmings to try and find satisfaction in the flesh, thinking that only by doing that can they really go forward to, you know, gratification, satisfaction, etc. This is the trouble that is coming. I mean, the trouble is brewing. And there's this last call feeling that's going to arise, and people are going to... Well, it's like that adultery website. It's just unbelievable to me. It's hard to even fathom what's going on in the world. We don't even know. This has been going on. I never heard of any such a thing. And apparently there's 33 million people or something signed up for it. Are you kidding me? I mean, this just shows you that they're saying, hey, I'm not experiencing the flesh in my marriage, so I need to go outside of it, and that's how I can experience it. And this shows you the acceptance of the people in this world of this kind of thing. You know, it's just, it's astonishing that how much things have changed, and people are, you know, desperately seeking something on the internet. They're seeking the flesh. Okay, let's just be honest. They're seeking the flesh. And we're telling you, I'm telling you right here and now, there's no such thing as the flesh. It doesn't exist. It never existed and never will. And then we think, oh my gosh, well, I'm lost at sea. No, we have a safe harbor. Come on into the safe harbor. Don't go out on the sea seeking flesh. The fishermen are going out in the sea fishing for flesh. Fishing for the flesh. I gotta catch the flesh. How can I catch it? And of course there's all these fish saying, hey, here I am, I'm the catch. If you catch me, you've got the flesh. And you know, the fishermen are saying, oh my gosh, you know, finally I can find the flesh, you know. And this is going to become, you know, just completely, everyone's going to go cuckoo here in the world pretty soon. And it's way worse than we realize, you know, the human trafficking, the human slavery, the young people being used for this. And don't think that they're not part of it, though. I think we think, oh, they're young, they're naive. No, they're not. They are spirit. They're not flesh. Age and perception, all this, is everything is a mirage, actually. So there's going to be a big, there already is in the world, of underage sex. And it's becoming more and more, as more and more refugees are pouring around the world, that they're going to be more and more prostitution. It's just going to become out of control. And this is all designed. Don't think that the prostitutes don't know what they're doing. They absolutely are exploiting. They say, oh, here's someone who's desperate to experience the flesh. And they say, you know, oh, here I am. You haven't met me before, but it's destiny. My gosh. Such incredible destiny. It's unbelievable. Look what happened. I told you I experienced this in a dream. Yeah, I was in a grocery store. And I was going through this crowded area, and there's this woman who kept being smashed up against me and the whole way. And I said, there's something odd, because... And then we looked at each other like, it's like, oh my gosh, destiny's just happened. And then I turned away, and I just walked out. walked away from it. And then later on, I saw her get in this gray sports car. I realized she was a prostitute. You know, this is the spirit of prostitution is in the world to an extreme extent. You don't realize how it's off the charts. And she was very furious. I thought I had him trapped. Got away. So tried to make it pretend like somehow destiny had thrust us together, where in fact she was the one that was actually doing it, pretending like, oh, I'm the crowd is pressing me here, but oh, destiny has put us together. How amazing it is. We have to take advantage of this once in a lifetime. This is meant for us. It's destiny, you know. And I said, no, it's not. No, it's not at all. This is deception. It's not destiny, it's deception. There is no flesh. So why waste time in trying to find it? Why waste time in trying to find what doesn't exist? You'll just get taken for everything and then thrown in the gutter. Guaranteed. I always say the goddess is really a prostitute. She's the queen of prostitutes, the whore of Babylon. That's the truth. That's the truth. Of course, she puts a nice smile on it because I'm the good flesh. You know, here's the good flesh. Here's the flesh you've been waiting for. Not that terrible flesh that exploits you and takes everything, throws you in the gutter. Not me. No, look, I'm the goddess. I'm the good flesh. I'm the nurturing flesh. I'm the kind, compassionate, and, you know, loving, tender, understanding, accommodating, flexible, you know, consensus building flesh. I'm the good flesh. Here I am, you know. This is what you've been waiting for. Yeah. And so that the good face, you know, puts on the good face, whore Babylon. Of course they put on a good face. And they even present themselves in a very demure, you know, way. Like, but it's like destiny, you know. Look how demure and nice I am. And yet destiny has pushed us together here. We have to take advantage of this. They're experts. It's an expert. The goddess trains her children, their prostitutes, expertly. And inexpertly too, in all different ways. And they say, yeah, the flesh exists, absolutely. You just don't know how to approach it properly. It's a mystery. You know, they say it's mystery Babylon, you know, or Babylon, mystery Babylon. You just don't know how to approach it properly. And so we're going to teach you. I'll train you. Don't worry. The goddess will train you. You know how to approach the flesh properly. And once you learn how to do that, then you really will experience it. And you'll have this incredible experience. And you'll realize, oh my gosh, I really am the flesh. And God really did create it. And, you know, blah, blah, blah. And it's complete lie, complete deception. The goddess absolutely uses you up and throws you in the gutter. Okay? And says, well, you just didn't have the right approach. You know, you're a born loser. What she'll tell you is, you know, you're just one of those born losers, that's why. No capability. You know, I couldn't help you. She says, I can't help everybody. She says, I can't help everyone. You know, I can't save everyone. There's some that are just, you know, just don't get it. They don't get it. They don't have the sensitivity to experience the flesh. So this is a, you know, a goddess thing you got to understand. And of course, this is her outline for everybody because it doesn't work for anyone. Born liar. We just have to learn to be more sensitive, more understanding, more compassionate. We just have to learn how to appreciate the flesh. And, you know, this is the whole gynocracy thing that's really run by the goddess, which is our idea of the flesh, that there really is flesh. Somehow, there is real flesh, and it's good, you know. We just have to find the good flesh. All self-deception, 100% self-deception. No truth to it whatsoever. We are not the flesh. We are eternal life. 100%. No exceptions whatsoever. See, Jesus doesn't say, oh, well, you just don't have the sensitivity for it. You know, he says, no. There's no exception whatsoever. You are all, without any exception whatsoever, eternal life. None of you have ever been flesh and never will be. No exceptions to it whatsoever. Completely black and white. There's none of this fuzzy goddess saying, well, maybe if you get more sensitive, you know, you need to learn more to embrace the flesh this way. And, oh, well, maybe you're just not good at learning this. Maybe you have a problem. Maybe, you know, or maybe you're incapable of it. Maybe you're exception to it. Some can reach the flesh and some cannot. All this compromise, this fuzzy, you know, muddled stuff. No, cut and dry, black and white. no exceptions whatsoever. We are eternal life, period. God only created eternal life, nothing else. There's no exceptions. Nobody can discard it whatsoever. There is no flesh, never has been, never will be. We can never experience what doesn't exist at all. It's impossible. No exceptions to it. This is Jesus. This is the truth. This is eternal life speaking to us. Jesus the Christ, Jesus who knows that he's eternal life. Jesus the Christ, Jesus the one who knows, I am eternal life. All is eternal life. That's why they call him Jesus the Christ. All is eternal life. Of course, they call him Christ, also meant the king. I mean, the kings were anointed with oil, so they said, Jesus the king. Yeah, well, the king has a kingdom, right? And Jesus says, my kingdom is the kingdom of eternal life, not this realm of imagined mortality and flesh. That's, and then Jesus says, my kingdom is your kingdom. My kingdom is your kingdom. Believe it. My kingdom is your kingdom. We are one. We both. This is our kingdom. We both belong to this kingdom. All of us belong to this kingdom. In fact, we never left. Prodigal son says, I can't come. I never experienced the flesh. And nobody ever experienced the flesh. It doesn't exist. It's this hypothetical, you know, death state. Spirit trying to prove that it died. Spirit thinks if it experiences the flesh, that means it died. And that means if it died, God died too, which means spirit's will changed the will of God, which means spirit's greater than God, which means then spirit has the will to resurrect itself from spiritual death, and then it can be happy. So we think that first we have to experience the flesh, then we can be resurrected to eternal life. So the Christianity says, oh, first Jesus became flesh and then died and then resurrected to eternal life. This is not true. This is not true. We can never become flesh. We can never experience flesh. We never left eternal life. And I'm not contradicting Jesus. I'm contradicting all the Christology from the church doctors, the church fathers, and who went back and forth, and struggled for 500 years or more, and still struggling to try and, accommodate their beliefs. This is not true. Jesus did not become flesh. Spirit does not become flesh. There isn't any flesh to become. The fact that Jesus appeared as a body doesn't mean that he became flesh. Because that's saying that the body is flesh, that it's not flesh. It's not anything. It's not anything defined at all, because every moment is completely free of every other moment. So how can we say that this is our identity, that our identity is possible to have an identity in appearancing? No, it's not. All potentiality is always omnipresent. It's impossible that there be anything such as true process, time, space, process, and form. It's completely impossible. There's no such thing as flesh. It's absolutely impossible in God's creation, and God's creation is all that there is. So I'm not at all contradicting what Jesus is teaching. In fact, I'm affirming his teachings. I'm just saying that the Christology that was eventually developed was a result of all sorts of compromises and political intrigues and forgeries and miscommunications and trying to accommodate this and this and, power struggles. Wait a minute, and trying to come up with some compromise. Say, okay, let's say Jesus is both the flesh and not the flesh, but how do we, and there's some hypostatic union that it's all one, somehow mysteriously we can't explain it. Basically say, let's just agree that we can't explain it, how Jesus became flesh and is also eternal life. Let's just agree that it can't be explained. Council of Chalcedon. That's really what they came up with. And this is what we've been told. Tradition, this is our tradition that, yeah, it's not explainable. It's not understandable. We just have faith that it happened. Because this simply plays into our scheme of trying to be greater than God. And we think, well, how can we have our cake and eat it too? How can we accommodate Jesus? And wow, eternal life came here, but we have to believe that it's in support of our plan, right? So they say, okay, how did Jesus support our plan of becoming flesh, dying to what we are, proving that we're greater than God, and resurrecting from this spiritual death and being greater than the new prime creator? How was Jesus affirming this, you know? And so they tried to come up with a definition. Jesus was not affirming it. He's saying it's impossible. It's completely silly. It's just a whim. Nothing's happened. Flesh has never happened. Time, space, and process form has never happened. It's just a misperception, a mislabeling, you know, a wishful thinkingness. It's never happened. And they're thinking, no, we have to get Jesus to affirm that it's happened, you know. We've got to get God to affirm that it's happened. And so they came up with this muddled Christology. It's completely muddled. Ultimately, they came up with this saying, we don't know how it happened, but let's just call it good, you know. Let's just say it has. And not, you know, I'm not putting them down in the sense that they tried their best. And honestly, they said they argued and confused. They said, wait a minute, you know, if it's this, it can't be this. And they said, well, if it's that, it can't be that. And how do we, you know, they're just, and eventually they said, my gosh, we're the emperor said, hey, we need peace in the empire, guys. So you don't want more persecution. You better come up with an answer that's acceptable to the empire. And they said, okay, let's just call it, we don't really know. It's a mystery. Let's accept the mystery. Let's accept this hypostatic union, that which we don't really know what it means. We don't really know what the logos and the word and the hypostatic, nobody really knows what it really means, and we'll accept that fact that nobody knows what it means. And anybody who says that it means it, let them be an anathema, you know. Anybody who says that, yes, I know the truth, let them be an anathema. Let us admit that we really don't know how it's going to how it really happened. We just if we keep believing that it happened, that, you know, maybe that'll be good enough. Well, guess what? It's not good enough. The tradition that we have is not good enough, folks. This is a fact. Full of forgeries too. I mean, because since it doesn't really work, you have to, you know, it's like, well, you know, to make some accommodations but it doesn't work. The Christology that they have doesn't work at all. It's a dance around the fact that they say, we don't know. We just hope that it's true. We just hope that the Spirit became flesh, and we just hope all this is the answer. We just hope it is. Let's have faith that it is. But we can't really reconcile it with our reason. We can't. So what the tradition we have in this world really is that it's saying, look, stay away from reason. Let's just keep going on faith that somehow something happened that reason cannot accommodate for at all. And this is not true. This is not true. Reason can absolutely accommodate the fact that it didn't happen. It didn't happen. Reason will tell us. The Holy Spirit is the voice of reason. Will tell us, no, the impossible did not happen. And of course, so we've been trained to stay away from reason, because reason will tell us that. And tradition, our tradition, Christianity, is to say the impossible happened, and there's no way to explain it with reason. So stay away from reason. Just go on faith that it somehow it happened. Yes, we can't explain it. We can't reason it out. It's not possible. And yet somehow, mystically, magically, miraculously, somehow, you know, our plan is going to work, and God's affirming it, and Jesus affirming it, and eternal life is affirming it. It's going to work. It's going to work. We just have to keep believing that it's going to work. Well, of course, this is totally contrary to reason. So we have a culture which really has not used reason. This is what I found out coming here in this world. I tried to use reason, and people said, what are you doing? You're crazy. You can't do that. It'll mess everything up. Rock the apple cart of tradition. But, of course, reason will tell you, well, the impossible hasn't happened. It never will. We never discarded eternal life. Not at all. So ultimately, it leads you to the conclusion, well, there is no flesh. Actually, there isn't any flesh. We're not in the flesh right now. There's no flesh to be in, actually. Nothing ever became flesh. Spirit never became flesh. So, the tradition, for example, of Christianity is not sufficient to protect us from this hideous exploitation that's coming in storm, etc. Designed to collapse civilization, designed for a lot of things that to pull us down into darkness, actually. And you see, like, conservative Christian people, you know, getting pulled down into all this stuff, right? You know, prostitution, underage sex, all sorts of molestation, you know, all these things are coming out that these the conservative Christians are, you know, their faith is not sufficient to withstand the temptation of these, you know, pirates who are plundering them, blackmailing them. Well, they'll blackmail, they'll sue them for all sorts of money, and, you know, give me this, give me this, give me this, give me this. I won't out you unless you give me all this stuff, I won't out you, that kind of thing. But so what we need to do is this attitude of forgiveness and understanding, which we do have now, and say, okay, that, you know, that's just par for the course, you know, that your tradition left you vulnerable to this, but we have some addition to it. Okay, not that we're flushing at all, no way. I mean, there's some good aspects to it all, we understand that, but the Christology that's resting on is not true. It's not true, and it was a compromise. Because basically, they said, we're going to be arguing forever here, and the Roman Emperor said, hey, you know, I can't have unrest, civil unrest throughout the empire, you know. So, you guys, you know, reach a creed. I want a creed from you. You know, I want a statement. Now, it must be said that the people involved really didn't want that. Okay, so let's be honest here. There's a massive amount of good in Christianity and positivity. The arguments they were having were being done in a spirit of, let's see if we can reach the truth here. Okay, but there was a lot of zealots exploiting the situation for their own purposes, stirring up riots, etc. And so they were under a lot of pressure in a lot of ways, but they were trying to come up with the answer. They were searching for it, which is fine. We needed to do that. And they weren't sure. They say, wait a minute, if Jesus is God and divine and eternal life, how could he become flesh and come? Did he really become flesh? And, you know, this is what they're trying. They were trying to figure it out, and for centuries and centuries they were struggling with this. But those are the intellect, the ones that were capable of reasoning. But the ones, you know, others with more ancient traditions, you know, pagan traditions, they say, hey, you know, a lot of exploitation happened, a lot of rioting. And secular power said, hey, whatever the religion is, I need to use it to unify the empire, okay? Plain and simple. Therefore, I have to have a creed that I can post everywhere throughout the empire saying, this is our creed, this is the creed of the empire, this is what you this is the law, this is what you must follow. And so the pressure was on the Christians to come up with a creed. And so ultimately the emperor pressured them into a creed. That does not mean that they all agreed with it, okay? So again, the undercurrents of Christianity are very powerful and positive in a lot of ways. But the secularization of it into a empire demanded a creed, and what they came up with, you know, no one was really satisfied. They said, wow, let's just, you know, we got to come up with something here. A lot of people said no. You know, they split off, their schisms, etc., and continued schisms. And of course, the Protestant Reformation was a schism over saying, hey, wait a minute, you know, we don't necessarily agree with all this stuff. Nobody was really truly satisfied with it, except the emperor saying, good, you know, now we can standardize and say this is the law throughout the empire. Language, culture, bordersness of, we have a, you know, a common language, so to speak. We come administrativeness. We have a common culture, which includes this religion, which people, all people, you know, they wanted. They want some sort of hope for eternal life. So here it is. Keep in mind that ancient people were very focused on wanting eternal life somehow. They said, you know, after this mortal life is over, gosh, I don't want to have any more of this. Can I find some eternal life somehow? You know, how? So they're the Egyptians, pagans, Gnostics, they're all very, Manichaeans, always very focused on somehow eternal life. So, you know, Rome invented a religion, Serapis, the religion of Serapis. And that was the religion of the empire. But Christianity came along and said, no, we got something better. That we have a better teaching about eternal life. So ultimately, that became more popular. And then Rome said, okay, look, we'll get rid of Serapis and we'll install Christianity as the official Roman Empire religion. But you must have a creed. This arguing must stop, plain and simple. So the apologists, the compromisers, they won the day. They said, okay, let's fashion some sort of legalistic creed document, Chalcedonian Creed. They had the Nicene Creed before that, that standardized it. But it's not right. It's not correct. They just they were put under pressure to come up with something, and they weren't really satisfied with it. Okay. And on their deathbeds, a lot of them were pressured into recanting. You know, saying, okay, I agree with the creed, just for the sake, you know, I want my followers, you know, I want to be my followers to say, okay, let's just go along with this, you know, for the sake of settling down. Let's settle down here. Let's settle down and build an empire here. And so Jesus was lost to them, you know, in doing this. But not everybody. Many still try to say, let me find within what the truth is. And I don't quite feel this is quite right. You know, the desert monasticism, trying to find. But they were put under a creed too. They were put under a law, a rule, and all this. And they say, you know, this you must, for the sake of standardization and empire. You know, it's like God wants, you know, this world to be an empire, wants it to all be on the same page. Let's agree with this. And they say, why? Well, these great church fathers, you know, came up with this. These great intellectuals, or, you know, Tertullian and Origen and Ambrose and Gregory the Great and on and on and on and on and on. You know, Cyril of Alexandria, Clement, Anthony, you know, Saint Anthony and. All these great spiritual towers of understanding, they all agreed that this is the right creed, you know, which is nonsense. They all disagreed. They didn't know. They were struggling. They didn't have the answer. I've gone back and looked at what they said. They didn't know. Nobody really knew. They couldn't quite figure it out. So we're told, oh, well, how dare you stand up to St. Thomas Aquinas and the doctors of the church and who all understand exactly. That's nonsense. None of them understood. None of them understood the truth. But we have the benefit now of 2,000 years of struggling with it. So, you know, I'm way clearer now than the church fathers, for instance. Way, way clearer. And even than the apostles, because Jesus said the apostles were not clear at all. They said, you don't understand what I'm here. Really, you won't understand for quite some time, he says. And you're going to have to go through a process, you know, gradually clarify. Listen to the Holy Spirit. Listen to the voice of reason. And ultimately, the truth is there is no flesh. There is no world, actually, at all. There's never been a world. So did St. Paul understand? Well, he had some understanding, but he was also confused. I mean, he thought the end of the world was coming right then. All that would be resurrected from the grave. I mean, he thought a lot of stuff. You know, none of that took place. So we think that the apostles and the doctors of the church and all of this are some super authoritative source of truth and there's no way in the world that we can know better than them. This is absolute nonsense. It's a total myth. Okay, it never happened that way. The way they put it together, they put everything together to try to get this uniform empire building, sustaining creed belief. You know, this is the way it is. It's set in stone. Don't argue about it. It's finished. We've you know, let's move on. But it's all nonsense. Okay. Because again, I say I'm way more clearer than the fathers of the church and even the apostles right now, because 2,000 years of working with this. Of course, I've incarnated many times, as many of us have, but you know, and plus having the benefit now of A Course in Miracles, which is Jesus's very direct teaching, studying that for almost 40 years, and with all the discipline and effort, much greater clarity now than the church fathers. So we're not bound by tradition. We don't have to be bound by tradition. But on the same hand, I'm very respectful and appreciative of everything they've done. Absolutely. But I'm sure that they're happy that somebody later on is starting to get it, you know, because they said, wow, we're just starting out here. We've got this, this is amazing. What Jesus did is amazing. We just don't know. Wow, it's such a huge wow. We don't know what to say about it. And yet they're asking us to explain it, you know, and just said, how about this? And someone says, no, how about this? Someone else says, how about that? And then, well, I can't, you know, we don't really agree and not sure, you know, what it is. So let's keep working on this. But I'm sure they're thrilled. They're thrilled. Actually, I had an experience. I told you this dream where all this gathering was in my front yard. And someone brought me into this gathering. Says, here he is, here. And apparently the gathering was for me. And I didn't know. I don't understand. What are you all gathered here for? And I was brought around every single one of these people here. Very, very wonderful people. They all greeted me with great acclaim. And treated me like I was somebody, you know, just outstanding. I said, what the heck's going on? I didn't understand what's going on. And then apparently I became aware that these were like the apostles of Jesus and the great Christians of history. We're all had a gathering and you know, I was brought into this gathering and they were treating me like I was somebody fantastic. And they were so appreciative of me. You know, they were just... You know, they were just overflowing with happiness to see me. And I said, wow, what's going on here? So this is taking a while to understand. And what it is that is their hope, their goal, their hope was that eventually the truth would start coming out. The real truth would be someone eventually would begin to put it together and get it. And apparently that's what's happened in my case. And this is why they were so appreciative of me. Because that was their, they said, my gosh, that this, all our efforts have been worth it, you know, that it really, you know, it really was worth it. We thought maybe, you know, we'd never get it, we'd understand. We're so happy that somebody finally did the work to free themselves from the tradition that we are supposedly established. And they just say, hey, we didn't really want to establish this set doctrine. We wanted this process of working with the Holy Spirit to continue the clarification of it. We didn't want to have this set in stone dogma and everything. And so seeing that I was able to break through it and get free of it and realize, you know, they were overjoyed about this. So I was very nonplussed about this. I said, what in the world, you know, why are they so happy to see me, you know? But it's sort of dawning on me now, you know, what this is probably about. I've been able to break through the entire history, you know, of Christianity, and which goes back all the way deep into Egypt, actually, and, you know, ancient roots, and appreciate everything they've done. I absolutely appreciate it, but not get stuck in it, you know. And I'm not going to, you know, bow down to what history says, you know, this and this and this. I say, well, no. You know, they didn't get it, really. Not really. They were working towards it, yes, and they were certainly closing in on it and doing good work and great work. But there was not a lot of abidance in eternal life. There was duality still, you see. But now we're getting to it. We've got to it. So I had a very difficult time with that dream. I said, who am I that you're giving me this great acclaim, you know? I didn't understand. I said, wow. I accepted it, but I was just sort of, you know, why are they so so excited to see me and so happy to see me and giving me all this great acclaim, like I'm the one they came here to celebrate, you know. It's like, wow. Because I know these people are very, very august people. You know, I said, wow. But truthfully, the truth be told, that I know historically, if you think, look at the apostles, you know, we think, oh, they're so awesome. Well, they did a great job, but they didn't, they were not clear about what was going on. They did the best they could. Jesus told them, you know, I mean, he said, who am I? And only Peter said, well, if only Peter, he said, well, you understand the best of them, you know, but even your understanding is not very good. You'll deny me three times, right? And Jesus knew very well that they would not understand, but they'd be able to get the ball rolling. And they did get the ball rolling. And that's what was needed. So all praise to those who got the ball rolling. That's the most difficult part, really. And they've been able to keep the ball rolling, but, you know, at some point you got to realize that there is no world. There's never been a world. There is no flesh. There's never been any flesh. There's no I based on the flesh, based on a world at all. It's never existed. Even right now we're looking at this. It's not a world, actually. These are not forms. These are not bodies. It's all eternal life. It's a living light. That's all that it is, actually. So, I don't know what's going to happen, you know, but it's possible that some sort of, you know, acclaim will come to me, or some really great, something great will come to me. It's possible. I don't know. I just have to go with it and accept it. Because when you work on this, you have to be humble and just you know, just say, let me just do the best I can and see if it's possible to do this. At the same time, respecting everybody that you're trying to, you know, clarify. Again, they didn't want to come up with a creed exactly. They said, no, we're not quite clear about this. We want to keep working on this. Okay. But, you know, the powers that be, which I say is what's the number one power? That which deals with our health, the belief in the health of the flesh. That puts enormous power saying we need a standardized system of how to get income from this. This is big business. Healing, health, preventativeness, all that stuff. This is the biggest business there is. This is the power structure of the world. And they said, hey, let's standardize it. Let's start making profits off of it here. And of course, that's what happened, isn't it? Roman Catholic Church is a standardization, and they made massive profits off of it, including the forgery of the donation of Constantine, which was an absolute forgery, which said that because of a healing that one of, you know, a Christian saint gave Constantine, Emperor Constantine, that Constantine then willed the whole Roman Empire to the Christian Church. It never happened. And because of that, the church was able to assert primacy over the wealth, everyone's wealth, lands, property, wealth, trade, everything. Because Christianity really became the new medical establishment. You get help from the Christian church, from prayers, from indulgences, from, you know, and preventativeness and afterlife help, and which is what people are really interested in, is the afterlife after they die, which is what Egyptian religion was all about. How do I go from dying mortal death to eternal life? Is there some way? And then they say, oh, well, sure, if you just, you know, pay a lot of money to the church and bequeath your estates when you die, bequeath your wealth to us, and this is actually, you know, legal because of the donation of Constantine, which never happened. It was a forgery. It was a forgery, you know. And this is coming to light now. And I'm sure the early Christians were appalled by this. You know, I mean, if they could see it, you know, in hindsight, say, oh my gosh, that's not what we had in mind. So I wouldn't have worked on this so much if I didn't care very deeply about it. You know, it's very important. There's so much truth in at the root of this, you know. Jesus has the truth and knows. And ultimately the truth is that this never, our belief that time, space, process, and form happened, never happened. Never happened. It was just a wish, a moment of a wish, wishful thinking, and that's it. It's not happening right now. It's not happening right now. Absolutely, it's not happening. It's just the memory. We're honoring the memory of our wishful thinking. We had one moment of wishful thinking, and it was over. And we're honoring the memory of that wishful thinking by continuing to, you know, believe that it that the moment of wishful thinking had some effects. So we're continuing to believe that, you know, but it didn't have any effects, had no effect whatsoever. So Jesus knows this perfectly well. Again, what's the biggest industry in the world? Health industry. Health of the body. That's what has the most power here in the world. How do you make money off that? Gain power, press, you know, every power, everything the ego wants? By telling people that they are bodies. By convincing us that the flesh is real. Or that the search for the flesh is all important. And that bodies are real, and that yes, that sickness and death and happens, and we need to, you know, try to forestall that as much as possible. And this is where all the money is in the world. This is where it all is. And so it's that industry which presented Christianity to us over the last couple thousand years that insisted that you know it conform to this industry. Now, it was an uneasy alliance, and the health industry really doesn't like Christianity because there's too many miracles in it. They don't know quite how to, you know, make it. They figured out ways to make money off of that. Like, a saint did a miracle. Let's get the saint's bones. Let's set up a church. Here are the bones. Here we have the bones. You can come to this church too, and maybe you'll get a miracle too. Of course, a lot of people did because they have faith. That they don't really need this illness, and God doesn't really require it of them, and the saint has somehow done some magic to atone for my, you know, badness or something. And so placebo effect caused, you know, help people get well all the time. I mean, there's so many miracles, like at Lourdes and various places you go there. If you have the right placebo mindset, you're going to get well temporarily. Absolutely. It doesn't cure you of the false idea that, you know, the belief in the flesh. It doesn't resolve that. So, of course, you'll keep trying to affirm that there's flesh, and to prove it, you'll keep getting sick and dying and go through this. But you can temporarily drop some of that. You can. So they figured out ways to make a ton of money off of that. But we're past that now. Past that now. They want the bones of the saints. They want the saints to die so they can get their bones. It's funny, right? But it's true. You have to realize Christianity's been a religion of relics of the saints. That's what it's all about. That's what it's always been about. Since it got put into that context of let's standardize it, let's start making money off this. Come on, guys. You know, you're killing me here. You can make a lot of money off this. Stop squabbling. And so let's get the bones. Let's get the bones going here. Start rolling the bones here and making some money. But the idea that, like, hey, I always said, I'm not going to die. I'm not going to die at all. You can't have my bones, you know. You can't have my bones. And in fact, let's drop this whole notion. You know, let's just ascend into light or whatever we need to do. We don't have to die. The body doesn't have to die, actually. And so we got to get past this whole, because, but they'll say, well, gosh, we don't have the bones. What can we do? You know, we can't build a church without bones. We need some flesh. We've got to say the flesh is here in this church. The flesh, spirit became flesh right here in this church. If you come in and acknowledge this, you're going to be healed. So the people come and say, okay, I acknowledge there's some mystery. We don't know what happened. Some incredible mystery that spirit became flesh. But if we just acknowledge this, that we'll be healed. And so with faith like that, they can temporarily cast aside any illness. You know, they think, well, I'm good with God now, so I don't really need this affliction. But they're not really good with God. So it's temporary, and it's not enough. And so we've become dissatisfied with the church. We've become dissatisfied with the religion of relics. And we become vulnerable then to science, technology, and all that stuff. They say, hey, you don't need the bones of the saints. You got these medicines now for you. This is what's going to be good. This is where all the money is now. So the money is in medicine now, and surgery, and hospitals, procedures, all that. It's not really in the church anymore. So that's collapsing. That's going away. But as it collapses, we become aware of the real truth behind the whole situation. And we say, hey, you know what? Jesus saves today. All right? Jesus lives today. The truth that Jesus came to bring us is true right now. And that is, there is no flesh. There is no world. We never became flesh. We never confined the flesh. God did not create the flesh. God did not create the world. God did not create any. God, what God creates is eternal life, and that's all that God creates. Everything that God creates is eternal life. There is nothing but eternal life. The only life there is eternal life. Eternal life is the only life that there is. So maybe you can see why I had that dream. That dream happened to me. It was such a surprise. And I had all these saints, Christian saints. I recognized them from the past. And prominent people in Christian history and everything. They were here, threw me a huge party. It was a surprise party for me. And they all wanted to meet me. It was like they were thrilled to meet me. And because they said, finally somebody is saying what we really wanted to say. And our continuity fear, we couldn't quite say it. We felt it, but we couldn't articulate it, and finally here's somebody who's able to actually articulate it for us. And this is what we really wanted to get to. And so they were just so thrilled by this, just thrilled by it. And keep in mind that in a previous life I was a great musical articulator. I was able to articulate music in an extraordinarily articulate way. So I felt maybe I can spiritually articulate, what it's really about. Let me do this. So maybe these teachers are thrilled by it, this is why maybe I've been contacted by them, and they're thrilled. I can understand it. I'm thrilled by it, I'm thrilled by being able to articulate this like this, this big picture that, hey, it's okay, we can say this here. There's never been any flesh, never happened. But it's been stay in the wow. I didn't just do all this work just to say I've done it. I want it to be successful. I want it to help others. This is the point. This is the whole point of it. Is we can get used to this articulation and realize, wow, it can be articulated this way. It doesn't have to be wrapped up in mumbo jumbo and mysticism and faith, and Greek words that can be taken 10 different ways and nobody really knows exactly what they're talking about. And they're just hoping that maybe, they throw enough stuff up there, something will stick. We're not stuck with that. We're not. I have this new, fresh, articulation of it. And we can take refuge under that. We can take refuge under that roof. And the saints are not angry with me. This is what they wanted to express. It's like the whole tradition of Christianity, the positive tradition of it, showed up in this dream, acclaiming me and thanking me so much. And, the truth, we're not stuck in that. And they don't want us to be stuck in it. I guarantee you that. They do not want us to be stuck in it. You don't think St. Paul is saying, my gosh, you know, I didn't quite get it clear, but I hope that the people in the future don't take it the wrong way and get stuck in it, you know? You don't think that St. Paul is feeling that way? Of course he is. He, you know, he, wonderful, St. Paul, wonderful. I mean, here's someone who's just on fire, but he realized, look, you know what? I may have made some mistakes. I may not understand it completely. I may have said some things to you, you know, but I'm trying my best. I'm trying my best, you know, but hopefully, you know, the mistakes that I made, you can forgive me for them and see through them, etc. That's the way they were. They're wonderful, wonderful people. Christians have been wonderful people, wonderful spirits, you know, wonderful spirits. Absolutely wonderful, the saints, but very humble, saying, you know, I hope we can make it even clearer, even clearer, even clearer. Let's work on this great work. Let's get this great work. Let's keep it going. So all praise to all of them, the tradition and all of them. And they don't have this attitude like we cannot get help from other traditions. They don't have this attitude, really. They said, look, let's get it right. Let's get it right. I'm not bothered. I've never been bothered by, I say, whatever can help us clarify, that's good. That's great. Let's get it right. Jesus wants to get, just wants us to get it right. That's all. They wanted to make, but the problem was they knew that this idea of making spirit flesh seemed so impossible and so difficult to understand. They wanted to say, it only happened once. It's such a rare thing. It could only happen one time. You know, they thought that if we say it could only happen once, that this would be acceptable, somehow acceptable to reason. We say, look, reason, we're not saying it's something that can, you know, we know you say it can happen, but we're not really saying it can happen a lot, but we're only saying it can happen once, so can you not at least give us just this once? And they thought by saying it just happened once, that this would somehow make it true. And so this is why there's a lot of emphasis on, no, Jesus is the only Savior, only happened once, only this. Yeah. By trying, they're trying to make a deal. They're trying to make a deal. We're not going to claim it can happen a lot, but can you just let us believe that it could happen once? Of course, Jesus has to say, no, it can never happen. There's no exception to truth whatsoever, not even one exception. And they were not ready for this. So they said, well, no, we're just going to say it could happen once, but no, we'll disbelieve everything else, Buddhism, you know, Advaita, you know, whatever. No, that's all nonsense. No truth at all. But only Jesus, because we made this deal with God, you know, and we got to be true to this deal. There was no deal made with God. Okay, there was no deal. God doesn't make deals. How can God make deals? God, all life is eternal life, period. There's no exception to it. So God, the messenger of God doesn't come to tell us that God has a deal for us, has made a deal, so to speak, comes to tell us that there's no exception to eternal truth, to eternal life. There's no exceptions from, but we can take an intermediate step. That's not a deal. That's just an acclimatization process. That's not a deal. God doesn't make deals. But they thought if we just say this is the only deal that God made, and we forsake all other wisdom, you know, then we won't have to use reason. But doesn't work, folks. It doesn't work. So I can accept Ramana Maharshi. Absolutely. I can accept Longchenpa, etc. I can accept absolutely not having the slightest problem with it. They know the truth too. There's no exception to truth. All life is eternal life. Absolutely. We all have to come to know this truth. Every single one of us. The idea that Jesus is the only one who knows this, you know, is nonsense. There are those who also know that all life is eternal life. Okay, and all of us spirits have to come to realize this is true. So we will all know it. We will all know it. So there's no problem at all in understanding, you know, wisdom from other traditions, etc. Not that they didn't have their problems too. Absolutely, absolutely have. So. The more the merrier, the more that are here who know that eternal life is the only life there is and nothing else has ever happened. Thank God for that. Thank God for that. Because the real saints are not these not the way that they've been depicted in history. It's the ones that tried to, you know, codify and you know, legalize, you know, get this one creed and say this is going to be the doctrine. You know, they're the ones who put the spin on it, the spin doctors, who are working for this notion of we have to have some sort of unity here so we can, you know, get the business of the healing business and the taking care of the body can be standardized, and let's, you know, they paint these pictures, you know, but these pictures are not really accurate. They're not accurate. Do we really know the saints? No, they're not really. The reason why a lot of people are frightened of other traditions, for instance, is they're afraid that they might point out that, hey, this you know, deal with God never happened. It can't happen. And you have to use your reason. They say, oh my gosh, whoa, I'm not ready for that. I have to go on faith that it did happen. And so they feel threatened by it, maybe. I don't feel threatened by it. Jesus didn't say a deal with God was done. No, absolutely not. This is all the spin doctoring that's taken place, a massive amount of spin doctoring for the purpose of empire, ultimately for the purpose of making money, ultimately for the purpose of healthcare. This was the healthcare for thousands of years, Judeo-Christian tradition, very much so. As was the old system, the Old Testament, that was healthcare system. Says, you do this, oh, I'm sick, okay, you've broken the law, God's law. Let me see what God's law is. Okay, right here it says, you know, in our, you know, right, our teachings, that you got to do this. Now, you must have broken the law some way. What they did was they made so many laws that they could always find some way that you've broken the law. And they said, oh, that's why you're sick. You got, on the morning of such and such and such, you got up too late on that morning, and you didn't do your prayers at the right time. You've broken God's law. And this is why you're out of harmony with God's creation now. This is why you're sick. So if you just go back and make sure you don't break any of God's laws, you'll be well. And they think, oh, that's great, okay. And then they start doing things right, and the placebo effect, they think, okay, I'm back in God's good grace now because I made atonement. They say, well, you got to make atonement. You got to go to the temple and give this X amount of money to the temple. But they don't want to get that crass, so they say, well, you've got to buy this animal, and then we'll sacrifice it, and this will restore the harmony that you disturb with God. And, of course, they control the whole selling the animal thing, right? And then you got to give something to the priest who does the sacrifices, but they're not directly asking for money. There's, you know, so they have to get all this intermediate stuff going. And so, of course, they make so many laws that you're bound to break them, and then they can always claim that that's why you're sick. That's the trouble. You broke one of God's laws. This is all completely made up. But the other people say, I just need some, you know, some way to understand why, what's going on here, you know, why am I mortal, you know, why am I suffering, and, oh, I broke one of God's laws, of course, that's the answer. But Jesus said, I came to bring a New Testament, you're free of the law, that's not the answer. We don't know if Saint Paul was, how great he really was or not. I mean, some people think he's the devil, you know. He maybe just said, wait a minute, because he was totally into the law and supporting that. Said, hey, this is a great healthcare system here. And then they look at Christianity and say, well, wait a minute, this is a better healthcare system. Let's get this going, you know. Which is, you know, who knows how much he was invested in this and that. But you can see positiveness too, you know. But whatever, you know, whatever it is what it is, and we have to get it clear right now. Let those who acclaim the clarity, let them acclaim it, you know, look at it that way. And if St. Paul claims it, then wonderful, totally accepting of that. I give everyone the benefit of the doubt in the past, the pressures that they're under, give them the benefit of the doubt. But you can see how someone might suddenly say, hey, wait a minute, using this Jesus story, that can be a much better healthcare system. We can, this is going to, you know, we're going to be even more rich from this. And this is, you know, we can be more powerful and make this great global empire and get everybody to believe in this, a placebo effect. And, you know, we just broke one law, you know, we just didn't accept Jesus. If you don't, if you accept Jesus, that then you're right. God only has one law, not all these laws, you know. Let's standardize it, make it simpler. Make more money that way. And, you know, you got to understand that's and, you know, very much in play, right? Very much in play in the past. Yeah. You know, they say, hey, you know, you only now it's a new dispensation, and now the only problem is none of these laws of God's laws are in effect anymore. God just has this one law now, and that is you have to accept that Jesus, you know, the Spirit became flesh in Jesus. And if you accept that, then God will forgive all your other transgressions. Yeah. It's one treatment for all transgressions, you see. And so if you just accept this one deal that God made, then God will be happy with you and not going to be angry with you about anything else, and therefore you won't have any more afflictions about this stuff. But the catch is, though, that accepting this one deal is very difficult. You know, and so they said, wait a minute, let's take all these laws and wrap them up into just one, make it simpler and easier. Of course it's difficult to believe how what can never happen happened, you know. So you can work at that one for a lifetime, can't you? Very clever, right? Very clever. Very clever. But also pretty transparent, like a child building sandcastle, you know. You can look at it, it's pretty obvious. Pretty obvious. Because they thought, oh, illness, God's angry with me. But there's so many laws, I can't help but break them. And then the Christian said, wait a minute. Don't worry about that. Don't worry about all those laws. There's only one law of God, you know, only one law. And that is you need to accept, you know, the sacrificial atonement of His Son, that He sent His only Son to die for your sins. And became flesh. How do you do that? Well, your Spirit became flesh and then was killed. And if you accept that, what God's remedy for you, God's remedy for you, if you accept that one truth, that Spirit can become flesh and die, and did so, do that, then God will not be angry with you about anything else. He'll say, wow, you got the big one. So all the other stuff, yeah, it doesn't matter. It doesn't really matter. That if you can believe this one lie, then all my anger at the other, not believing the other lies, don't matter. You see, He's not going to be angry about it. And so it's this wonderful, clever, you know, consolidation sort of thing. But keep in mind, that is not what the early Christians believed at all. This is what ultimately coalesced through centuries and centuries and centuries. A lot of spin was put on it. There was great disagreement among what had happened with Jesus. Great disagreement. A lot of what is standardized now was not at all present at all in ancient times. The goddess worship was already present in Roman times. I mean, like Ephesus was the center of who they worshiped. Artemis or various goddess there or something. Goddess worship was all over the place, from Egyptian religion and pagan religion. And the cult of Mary did not arise for quite some time. Like early Christians would know nothing of such nonsense. There was no Mary. Jesus didn't establish a Mary cult at all. Nothing like that. So all of the stuff that we have now, it was stuff that spinning. Jesus came to tell us that there is no deal with God, and we don't need to make a deal with God, because there's no such thing as mortality. There's no such thing as a body. There's no such thing as a world. We've never discarded our eternal life. So why do we need to make a deal? It's like we haven't become something else, and we need to make a deal to get back what we lost. We're not lost unto ourselves at all. Just the way a dreamer is not really lost unto themselves, even though they don't realize it. All I have to do is wake up from the dream. They say, oh, I was never lost to myself, actually. But we spun it into this belief that, oh yeah, there's this one deal, and this is what God wants. God's tired of judging us for all these transgressions. He only wants to consolidate now and say, no, this is the real reason why you're sick, is because you don't believe that spirit can become flesh and die. You know, that's the reason why you're really suffering. You know, and of course, it's just the opposite. The reason why we're suffering is because we believe that spirit can become flesh and die. That's why we're suffering. So really, it's just, if you disbelieve this, then you'll be healed, actually. It's funny, like they reversed it. You know, what Jesus really wanted, they completely turned it upside down and reversed it. It really should mean, if you just believe that spirit can never become flesh, no matter what the appearances may seem to be, no matter whether you think that there's an appearance that you call a body, whether you think there's a situation called mortality, spirit can never be a body, spirit can never suffer mortality. If you just believe that, then you will truly be saved from this ridiculous pretense that such a thing is even possible. And then you realize, I don't need any deal. But I can take an intermediate step of pretending to be eternal life so I can overcome this continuity issue that I have. Yeah, but that's just a temporary delaying mechanism to just let the continuity fear evaporate. It's not a deal with God. Were there strong placebo effects experienced back then? Absolutely. Because when they consolidated, they felt, hey, wait a minute. We don't have to worry about all these other laws. We have one cause for our sickness now. And if we just accept this, we're free of God's wrath. So of course there are going to be massive placebo effects when you do something like this. Of course there'll be people healed right and left. Of course they'll relapse later and still die, etc. And they'll even be imperishable bodies, you know, like that can happen. Absolutely. There's a very strong placebo effect from this, and yet that is not what we're getting at. That's not what Jesus is really getting at. It's getting at the truth that I've never been a body. And not only I've never been a body, there's no such thing as a body. There's no such thing as flesh. It doesn't exist. It has never existed. Not even for an instant has flesh actually ever existed. We had one instant of wishful thinking, but it had no effects. And what is just mere wishful thinking is not real. Okay, so the body has never existed. Form, flesh has never existed. Time has never existed. Space has never existed. Process has never existed. Form has never existed. None of that has ever been present, ever. The Christians, they wanted to get it right. They want to get it right. But, you know, the ego and the way it turned out, you know, the powers that be flipped it and says, hey, no, wait a minute, you know, we need to keep having people get sick and make money off of this. And so let's just use this powerful placebo effect, which it was, and make a bunch of money off of it, to be perfectly frank. Yeah. That's what actually happened. It is a powerful placebo effect, no question. When you go from the Old Testament legalism to discarding all of that, holy cow, it feels like you're free. It almost feels like, oh my gosh. And you know, I'm not really breaking. If I just accept this one thing, then God forgives me everything, all the others. You know, so I don't need to be sick for all those others. I don't need to be worried about all that. And that can give you massive placebo effect. And it did happen, absolutely. But that's not the answer. We're not after a placebo effect. We're after abidance in eternal life is what we're after. Which is what they were after. That's what we're all after. Do you really think that the whole longest, or what's the world's oldest profession? Healthcare. Making prostitution and healthcare. Healthcare is the oldest, prostitution is the second oldest. And prostitution's like, hey, you know, your problem is you really haven't experienced the flesh. That's why you're sick. You know, and you, here's the, I can give you that experience of the flesh for a certain fee, you know. And so the two go together. But healthcare is the oldest profession. And there, this is what drives, has been driven the economy of the world. Okay, so you don't expect people who completely in this whole system to suddenly just drop it like that. No, they're thinking, they're going to say, wait a minute, I just see a better way of doing it. I see a better way of doing it here. Hey, maybe this is going to work even better. Let's have the Serapis religion and baptize people for the remission of their sins. If they just believe in this and this and that, you know, then okay, it's, you're all good with God. And whew, people say, wow, what a relief, you know. And then someone says, let's make it even better, you know. Maybe we can use this Jesus situation to make it even better. Let's make this more money. Let's streamline. Let's incorporate. Let's be efficient about it here. And we get the bones of all these saints. Yeah. Let's do that. That'll work great. And we can spread it throughout the world by just having all these churches everywhere and put the bones of the relics in these churches and say this is where you go for your health care. And, of course, massive placebo effect. So don't worry. You're not messing up. You're only messing up in one area. You haven't quite accepted that spirit became flesh. So you got to work on that. And I mean, this might, you know, you may not be able to get it, but keep coming, keep working on it, keep supporting the church, etc., and maybe you'll get it. These saints got it, you know. That's what they say. See, they got it, and we got the relic right here, so you can get it too. Now, were there legitimate saints? Probably. A lot of spin doctoring happened with them, you see, and the ones running the healthcare system, which is what the church really was, made sure that, you know, the story that got out to the populace was, this is what really happened. This is what the saint really wants for you. This is the way you need to look at it. And the narrative, they controlled the narrative. You know, it was a battle of who was going to control the narrative in the early church. There was this huge battle. Who's going to control the narrative, and what sort of narrative was it going to be? And eventually that got standardized, more or less. The Reformation shook it up, but still kept a lot of the standard narrative, actually. It wasn't as much of a Reformation as we like to think, actually. I know the Protestants think we've really got it right, but no, they kept the basic stuff. They just said, we think we'd be a little more efficient with it here, and you know, we don't need the bones necessarily, like, right? I mean, let's get back to the central placebo thing teaching. But no, so I know this is like, wow, you know, wow, we're hearing this. Wow. Well, that's great. Yeah, absolutely. But we're supposed to hear this. It's the apocalypse. We're lifting the veil on history. You know, it's all, we're now all seeing, okay, let's determine now what's our destiny, what's the next step now. And we have the truth here, the four phases of practice. We understand that we forgive ourselves, is what we realize that we've made mistakes and we need to correct these mistakes. And we can, plain and simple. God's not mad at us. Jesus is not mad at us. Jesus just wants us to get it right. That's all. He's already back. He said, I'm just here just to relate as a friend with you, as an equal, as a friend now. Who wants to relate? I'm not angry with anybody. He understands that we're going to got caught up in this placebo thing. We thought we could make a lot of money and find happiness and mortality and et cetera, et cetera. And that after the mortal body died, then we have eternal life. There is no mortal body. It's never existed. It's a fantasy. But imagine trying to come here and teach that, right, to the world with its, you know, this vast Godzilla monster of the hell system. That's the last thing they want to hear. There is nobody. It's just a fantasy. And they don't want any evidence that it is. So they spin that evidence. They spin it. And of course, the more powerful placebo effect is to say that only this placebo works. Only Jesus works. So that's central to their the placebo healthcare system, is that nobody else works. Only this works. So we can only come to these churches, right? Don't go to some other church that they'll get our money. You know, no. Only Jesus works. Only the Jesus placebo works. You know, that's it. I say, well, wait a minute. Didn't somebody else from this other, be also appearance of eternal life? And didn't they know the truth also? And didn't they do all these miracles too? And no. Those are all lies. Those are all myths. Those are all the work of the devil, work of Satan. You know, now only come to this church. You know, this is the only healthcare system there is. That kind of thing. We got a monopoly on it. Of course they want to monopolize healthcare systems. Oh, they want to monopolize. Of course they do. You don't think that those insurance companies and healthcare providers, they want to monopolize? Of course. They want to stabilize. They think monopoly is stabilizing it. So of course I know that others have been enlightened about the situation, about eternal life. Of course they have. Of course they have their health care systems too, you know, that know only, but some of them are not quite that way, actually. For some reason, Judeo-Christianity tends to be very monopolistic. It's derived this monopolistic, capitalistic system, you know. And they want to say, no, this only this, you know. It works better if we only have one placebo. Which, from a placebo standpoint, you know, is accurate from a placebo standpoint. You think it's all here, and it's all right, you know, this, then, wow, very potent placebo effect. Very powerful healthcare system. And they're very jealous or zealous about protecting that. You know, everything else is nonsense.